When she hooked me up with the agents, yes. And they signed me, you know, to represent, and then I went on an interview for the second pilot, which I talked about, which I was recasting with Carl. And you know, it's funny, I was 5 years old and I remember it vividly. And at the end, Carl just kind of went, there was two people it came down to, and Carl kind of went with me because he just wanted, this other kid had done some acting, he'd done some commercial work and stuff, and he was like a year or two older than I was. And Carl said, no, I want somebody that's just never been in the business. Somebody I can just bring in as a fresh kind of like a whole new, you know, being of sort to just become who he is and be just the person he is. And that was the beauty of the Dick Van Dyke Show in a lot of ways. If you look at Dick Van Dyke today, Dick is Rob. He is. Dick is just Rob Petrie. You talk to him, you talk, you know, you be with him one-to-one. He is who he is, and he's a great guy. Mary was Mary, you know. I was who I was, Rosemary and Maury Amsterdam, they were just who they were, and we just basically took those personalities and made them into a show. And it was just wonderful, and it worked really well, and again, it's just very fortunate that we've been able to have such an amazing, you know, run, if you were, or just still be around today, after all this time, so.
And your favorite episode of yours is mine, I think, about the duck.
Yes, it was. It was Never Name a Duck. Yeah.
Remember when the duck, okay, talk about that scene in your room.
Great story. And I believe as a child, and you know, it's so funny, you'll relate to this as a child actor. You do things and they're funny, and you react and you're like, oh, it's kind of funny. You start laughing and you're not supposed to. You're not supposed to like being like acting seriously. So that particular show was the one show that I had to be very, very serious, and I was upset, and I was a kid. I didn't know, you know. To me, it was like when my dad beat me, I was unhappy. But other than that, no, I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. Anyway, but point being, like you, as a child, you don't really understand how to bring emotions out and stuff. So they were giving the ducks away. Rob was going to put the duck back into the wild because one had died and we couldn't keep the other one. And so I was supposed to be in the scene with Rob telling me this, and I was supposed to cry and be very upset about it. And I went to my mom, and I said, Mom, I said, you know, I don't know how to do this. I mean, like, I'm not upset. I'm like, you know, I'm on a television show, and I'm like, you know, she goes, you know, she goes, go talk to Mr. Reiner. Mr. Leonard, Sheldon Leonard. And she goes, and tell him that, and he'll help you out. And my mom was pretty smart about that. So I went to Sheldon, and I said, you know, I got to do this scene. I have to cry. I don't know how to do that. And he goes, you know, it's just, and literally, the wall was here for the stage, because the stage was out here. We were live camera, you know, we were three camera live, and we were up there, and I was behind the door to go into Richie's room when that scene took place. And Sheldon kneels down in front of me, and he says, son, he goes, let me tell you this. And he tells me this heart-wrenching, horrible story about his dog.
Oh, no.
And I was a big dog. I mean, I love animals, and I still do. I'm just a big animal person. And he says, you know, how he told me a story of how he had this great dog, and it was this love of his life and family, and it got killed in an accident, and it died, and I was devastated. And in like 5 minutes, I was like, oh, you know, I was pouring tears out. And they went like, okay, action. And literally, I went on a set, and I was there. And it was amazing how the scene, and I, to this day, I've told Herbie this before, I believe it still was my best work as a child actor in terms of being a real actor, not just being myself and being Richie. I was actually acting to do a scene. And it was a wonderful experience. And Sheldon Leonard is such a brilliant, brilliant man. amazing. He just knew how to get that, you know, make that work for you. So it's
pretty cool. I remember that show.
Yeah.
Well, in the 1960s, which is, you know, which is the focus this week, you know, certainly there was President Kennedy and his wife. Do you believe, and some have said this, and some have made the connection before, that Robin Lahr represented JFK and Jackie?
Or well, another in interesting, some way? Interesting story, and, you know, and what, 2 years ago was the 50th anniversary of JFK's assassination. And there was a bunch of stuff going on Facebook, and, you know, I'm like, do you remember that? Do you remember that? And I didn't post anything, because I don't post a lot of stuff, but I remember it was very vivid. We were actually in the middle of rehearsing an episode. It was an episode where Rob had come to school to speak for Richie. He was the father of the week. And he had come to school and speak, you know, as a father of the week. And Richie was very embarrassed because his dad was a comedy writer. I'm like, oh my God, you know, this guy's a fireman, this guy's an airplane pilot. My dad's a writer. I don't know. It's a very funny thing. Comedy writer. And we were rehearsing and blocking that episode, and the news came on that Kennedy had been shot. And we had a prop radio in the middle of the back wall of the Petri living room. As you walk back to Richie's room and out the front door, there was this like little stereo old complex where they had like a radio and a phono player. And we didn't even know if it worked. We plugged it in, we turned on the radio, and we all sat there and listened to Walter Cronkite, right? Mm-hmm. Call the assassination of Kennedy. Mm-hmm. And it was like unbelievably emotional. It's as vivid as in my mind as today is right now. And Carl Reiner came out and said, we're done. We're going home. Everything's done. We're going home. And stopped rehearsal. And we literally postponed the show and didn't shoot the show till the next week and came back and picked up blocking because of what happened. So,
well, that
in answer to your question,
yes.
And we were very sensitive to that, and Rob and Laura were, I believe, really the embodiment of that 60s type of family and couple who were very affected by everything that happened. However, that being said, one of the great things about the Dick Van Dyke Show and Carl Reiner was Carl never did any episodes about what was going on at the time.
Yes.
Because he never wanted to make it to pigeonhole it into a time-stamped event. So, all that being said, he was very conscious to go, you know what? What happened to you this week? What happened to you this week? What happened to you in the summer? What happened to you this? What happened to you this? And they would write episodes, Gary. You know, a great episode Gary wrote was about the Liberty Bell. I don't know if you remember. It was like called Odd But True. And it was my Millie and Jerry's son, who was on with a few episodes, and me were in the house one day, and Rob was sleeping on the couch, and we looked, and there was freckles on his back. And Gary wrote this episode. And we connected the dots on the freckles, and it made the Liberty Bell. And we submitted it to Odd But True, which is like, you know, remember they always like, you know, believe it or not, exactly. And it was like, and Rob had to go in there, and then I'll show the Liberty Bell and draw the answer. But that was Gary's episode. So, not anything ever that would associate it with a time frame, but just stories that would last forever. And that was like...
Well, it's so interesting, too, because 1963, November 22nd, 1963, is the day that Bewitched began rehearsals. And it would be opposite happening with Bewitched. Elizabeth Montgomery and William Asher were good friends with the president. As a matter of fact, Bill Asher, who was Elizabeth's husband and who directed the show, directed the inauguration, where I believe Marilyn Monroe sang "Happy Birthday."
Correct, Mr. President. Yep.
So, and then he died, or he was assassinated, November 22nd, and they shut down rehearsal. Excuse me, they kept going. So you guys shut down.
Wait, we shut down.
And they kept going. So there you go. It's interesting how the dichotomy there. Any questions here for Larry Mathews?
At your age, how did you remember lines?
That's a great question, actually, because I couldn't read, obviously. Although, actually, because I had a private tutor, I learned to write script before I could print, which was interesting. So I was, but my mom would get the script, and she'd tell me the lines, and I'd repeat them, and that was how we learned our lines. She was back and forth. So no, there was no reading. It was her telling me the lines. I remembered them. It was easy.
Did she teach you the cue line also? Did you have to memorize
Absolutely.
That?
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
Interesting.
Yeah, it was pretty interesting. It was pretty amazing, actually. And then even as I got older, when I could read, it was easier for my mom to do. Fine. Tell your mom. Okay, good. At 9 years old, what? Yeah, fine. Okay, great.
Mr. Michael Stern.
Since Dick and Mary were really not your parents, but was there ever a time that they scolded you? Like?
No, Maury did, but and Rosemary for sure. She was like, Rosemary and I, it's funny, Rosemary and I, and she has the same birthday as I do, as you guys know, it's coming up in a few weeks, actually. And Rosemary, being the Italian she is, and me being Italian, we have just this really wonderful connection, and so, Dick and Mary never did that, but I always felt they were always very like my parents, because they were just very close and they were very nurturing and helpful. Like if we'd be on set and we'd be doing something, and you know, I'd be like, and Mary would go like, no, do this, or Dick said, we'll do this, and so they were very, you know.
Well, Mary's son was named Richie.
Richie, he was, yeah.
Ironically. Now, but you weren't named after him.
No.
It just was like a coincidence.
It was coincidence. So yes,
hi.
There was some of that, and okay. But really, Rosemary and Maury.
So what did you do that, Maury? Yeah, there must have been a reason.
No, Maury was an awesome guy. Maury was amazing. Maury was just such, and he was such a wonderful man. I remember at his funeral, Jack Carter got up actually and talked.
Just passed away.
And he said, you know, something about Maury was amazing. He goes, Maury never had a negative thing to say about anything. If Maury, you ask him, how you doing? I'm great. What's going on? I'm wonderful. It was like, you know, there was never like, you know, even in that like minute where like, no, never. Maury was just truly a wonderful, wonderful, happy guy, and he exuded that. And so I related him a lot, and again, Rosemary and I we're still very close. I talk to her all the time. And yeah, she's like a second mom.
And Morgan Gilbert.
Annie, I love.
Nellie.
Yes.
Who did the nanny.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Years later, decades
later. I have a question. At the time of the show, did you get recognized as a kid?
Yes, I did.
Signed autographs? Yeah, I did.
Yeah, it was funny. Again, because my parents, my upbringing was very, you know, Italian, Catholic, humble, kind of like that.
I know, exactly.
So, yes, I would. My dad would say, well, to me only, but not to everybody else.
Right.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. You know that.
I do.
Yeah, it would, and it was very kind of like, again, it was like, I didn't quite get it.
It was trippy.
I signed my name. But as the years went on, and again, with some advice from some very wonderful people who said, you know what, you're nothing without the people that want to watch you. So if somebody ever says, hey, can you do something where you're like, yeah, I can, not a problem.
Did your siblings, were they around you during this time? How'd they react to it?
Well, it was interesting because we're, you know, my oldest brother's 72, so there's like a 14-year gap between the kids. They were great because basically as my mom would take me to work and stuff, they actually picked up and did a lot of the household stuff and would, you know, take care of the other kids and stuff. So, you know, they were great, and we're still very close, all of us.
Yeah.
You know, and we're all...
So now, you're very sane. Okay.
Well, that's debatable, but okay.
And you're well adjusted. I mean, you work in the industry, but not on camera.
Correct.
I mean, how do you explain that you did not fall by the unfortunate wayside, like so many, like the Danny Thomas show?
Rusty, who I knew very well, and you know, and Jay North, I know very well.
Dana Plano.
Jay said, yeah. Really, it's your family, it's your parents and your upbringing. It's how you're brought up as a child and taught what's important, what's not, what's fun, it's everything. So my dad again was very like, you know what, you just go play out the pool, go pick up the dog crap. No, I'm like, there was no special treatments
right.
when we were at our house. So that really helped you just kind of understand
that feet on the ground.
Yes. You're just exactly.
And Cindy talks a lot about that in her book. You know, she's a very real person. It's one of the reasons why I always loved her, and when what she brought to Shirley. But yeah, I think what I tell people all the time in my sometimes on my life coach blog and certainly on my obsessive compulsive email list, and some of you are on, I bring it up all the time. But is that you, whatever you do, you know, whether it's an actor or an accountant, people say, what do I do for my career? You live your life first. Live your life. That's the best thing you can do for your career, and then your career somehow sprouts up from around that. But and it keeps you grounded and sane.
Well, and I think also that, you know,
and don't think that your job, whatever you do, makes you better.
No. And I think that as you learn things, you're like, you know, what do I love? And if you do something you really enjoy and love, whether you make money or not, eventually you will be successful at whatever level or degree you want to be at. You know, and I've been in post-production and sales for, you know, 30-something years, whatever now. And I enjoy it. I like it. You know, we do a lot of reality shows. We do a lot of, you know, but I like my clients. I like going to work. I like the place I work at. And it just, it'll make you successful just because that's what you enjoy doing. It's like, you know, yeah.
What would the six, yes, sir.
Hi. Why did you decide to go from the front of the camera to the behind the cameras?
It's a great question. It's real simple because it was a real pain in the ass to try and get in front of the camera. Okay, because what happened was when I was, you know, I went through high school and I got my high school to Notre Dame High and I went to UCLA. And when I got, I'm like, okay, I want to go act now. And I go, like, I'll do some, you know, photo shots and pictures and make some headshots and all that stuff. Get my agent back again. And in my mind, I'm going like, well, hang on, I was on the Dick Van Dyke Show. You should just want to hire me, right? Not at all. It was a very big dose of reality very quickly. Yeah. And I went on some interviews, and there were like these, you know, 50 people cattle calls, and you're in there, you've been there. It's like, you know. And I'm like, okay, I don't have the energy for this. I'm sorry. This is not good. So that's why I went into post-production, production, and stuff behind the scenes. And as Alex, also as a kid, I loved it. John Rich, who was just the most wonderful guy in the world. And John directed about half of our episodes, and he was our director for the first 2 years or 3 years. And I always loved watching John and watching him look at the cameras and kind of just watching him direct and just pull everything together. And I was fascinated by that. And so I kind of would sit with John, and he'd be like, here, he'd set me up on the dolly and look through the cameras. We're going to do it. He'd show me all this stuff. And I was, you know, 6, 7 years old. And it was great. So I got a real, you know, connection from being behind the scenes and a real kind of love of what happened to put everything together, because what we do is only a very small percentage of what goes on to make a television show. Mm-hmm. And everything else people don't really get. You know, my wife's from Iowa, and I always joke and I say, these people look at me and they go like, oh, you know, you're an actor, you're a kid, you're rich, you're nothing, everything's crazy. I said, no. You don't even know what goes on. You have no clue. You think you look at the TV and you go like, oh, it's just wave the wand. Or, no, there's so much that goes on. And it's just, it's incredible. So it was a really wonderful thing to learn and to get into. So yeah, that's what I did.
That's great. Do you sometimes have a niche to go back?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I'm so glad you're honest about that.
Absolutely.
I think everybody does.
I love
they
it.
Say no. Fibbers.
Yeah, they are, Cindy. And I've done a lot of voiceover. I've done a lot of Loop Group stuff over the years.
Yeah.
I did like Family Guy,
we
did like a lot of
Loop
Family Guy.
It was
a blast. Mm-hmm. I was the first chicken in the chicken
pot. In the chicken pot?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
I remember that. Didn't you have to cry in that also?
Yeah, I did. It was cry, yell, scream. Was tough. And then Family Law and a bunch of other shows I've done. So I love it. And yes, I do, absolutely. And if somebody calls me up and says, Carl Reiner says to me, when we did the reunion show, it was in 2004, and I only had one little scene at the beginning where I was on the phone with Alan Brady, which is Carl. And I understand, Carl, you know, when I first read the script, I'm like, well, damn, I'm kind of disappointed. I don't have a bigger role. I mean, I only have this one little scene to do. And I'm like, I can do more than that, you know? It's like, and I kind of went through that with my wife, and I'm like, and then I got over that. She's like, calm down, right? And I'm like, okay, fine. And then I got to the point where, like, you know what? I'm just going to do the absolute best. I'm going to make this the most amazing, best little scene I can ever do in my life. And I did it. And Carl and I were rehearsing at the end of the rehearsal. He came with me, says, like, he says, you know, he says, what have you been doing all these years? you're great. You did this so well. And it was a phone conversation with Alan Brady. And Mary Tyler Moore came up to me during the rehearsals and said, you know what? She goes, you're amazing. She goes, phone conversations are the hardest things to do in TV because the timing has to be so perfect. What have you? I said, you know what? I just did the best I could. She was like, I'm so proud of you. You're just such a one. And Carl said to me, Carl goes, you're great. You're great. You're amazing. Your timing, everything's perfect. He said, what have you been doing? And I said, well, you know, Carl, I'm a salesman. I act every day. And he was like, no, I get that. But no, I said, nothing. I said, and I said, but if you think I'm that great, then hire me for another job, okay? So that's
all you're going to do. I was disappointed that you didn't have more to do in that. And if you guys ever saw the reunion, it was, you know.
The premise was that Robin, Laura had moved out of New Rochelle. Richie had taken the house over with his family and kids.
I'm going to the restroom. I'll come right back.
I'll wait.
No,
I really won't, but it's okay. Don't worry.
I just want you to miss this.
And Alan Brady was getting old and wanted to hire Rob and Sally to write his eulogy so he could actually control what they said about him in his eulogy before he died. And that was the premise of the show, which is very funny to think about. It was like, you know, total Alan Brady. And so it was him calling me, saying, where's your parents? Oh, they're here. And then them writing the whole eulogy and getting on through it. That was the premise of the show. But,
well, we're going to edit this part out because the only issue, that I had a couple issues with it, but the main issue that I had was that everybody was who they were. You know, Dick Van Dyke was playing Rob.
Yeah.
Millie, God bless her, she's so on the money. She was right back in that character. But Mary, and remember, cut this out. Mary, I thought, was doing Mary Richards, married to Rob Petrie. And this happened too when Robert Young did the first Father Knows Best reunion. The first episode he did, he was doing Marcus Welby. He was still stuck in Marcus Welby. It was very interesting to see. And the other thing is, you had owned the house that Rob and Laura owned, right? Mm-hmm. You still had the same furniture.
Yeah. It's only 40 years later. Don't worry. It's all good. You know how that furniture lasts. It's not a problem at all. Absolutely. Same painting. Same paintings. That same. Oh, like, oh, yeah.
And the crazy thing is that the retro furniture is in today. Thank you very much. The one and only.
Oh, I don't want to follow that. Oh,
now, we're focusing on the 60s here, and Cindy is connected with two of the most monumental 60s-oriented entertainment products, American Graffiti and Laverne and Shirley. Mm-hmm. What was interesting, though, about Laverne and Shirley is, you know, it was a spinoff from Happy Days. But when they did the show, and Happy Days was based in the 50s, but when you did Laverne and Shirley, it was the 60s. So did you recall any of, let's open with that, did you recall any of that issue with it being in the 60s, you were in the 60s, but Happy Days was in the 50s?
Well, because Penny and I came into it so fast, and it just all sort of snowballed, we never thought about it until, I remember having the discussion with her one time. Wait, where are we? Are we in the 50s or the 60s here? Seems like the 50s, but then we did a show where it becomes not. It was New Year's 1960, so I guess we were in the 50s, late 50s, like 1959.
And you didn't do any more crossovers with Happy Days?
Oh yeah, we did.
Oh, you did.
Well, we did the first one, and then we did about four or five others. They just had us crossing over for the fun of it, and then they would cross over onto our show. But, you know, Penny and I, when we first came into Laverne and Shirley, we've been writers together. And I didn't own a television at the time, and Penny, even though her brother was producing and writing Happy Days, she had never seen an episode. Neither of us had. And he just called us one day because we were a writing team at the time for this comedy movie that was being made. And he called us and said, hey, we've got these two parts on Happy Days, two girls, Laverne and Shirley, who date the fleet. And I was thinking about you and Cindy, because I knew him, because he had a management company that I was rep by. So he called and we said, okay, you know, we'll come and play the two girls who date the fleet. So we went over and we had no idea what the show was about, or we knew vaguely what it was about, but reading the script, Penny and I had our own take on it. So we played these girls the first day of rehearsal. It's total floozies. I mean, just chewing gum. We were smoking, of course, because we had no idea you couldn't smoke on television. And so we were smoking when we made this entrance for the first rehearsal, fixing each other's lingerie, you know, each other's bra straps and everything, taking pin curls out of each other's hair, taking that last drag on the cigarette. When we walked in, and then we spot the boys and we flick the cigarettes across the stage and walk toward them. Well, Jerry Paris, who directed the show, and Terry, who was my stand-in for all the years on Laverne and Shirley, right here today, Terry!
And Jerry Paris played Jerry Helper.
Jerry Helper on the Dick Van Dyke Show.
And, yes. and he directed a bunch of Dick Van Dyke shows.
With a microphone?
No.
Happy Days. He directed
no.
all the Happy Days, or most of them, anyway, right, Terry?
Yes.
And he directed with a microphone. So when we came on and did this, and this was literally our first time on to the set, flicked those cigarettes across, started walking toward Henry and Ron, who were our dates at Arnold's, and he yelled through this mic, stop, you two, stop right there. He said, smoking? He said, this is family hour. You don't smoke on the family hour. Well, Penny and I had no idea what he was talking about. And so we said, all right. And so we went back and we'd like talked to each other and said, what are you doing? Well, and the cigarettes were gone and we just chewed the gum and did the rest of the stuff. I don't think we adjusted each other's lingerie. And so that's how we began. You know, our trek on Happy Days and Laverne, and eventually Laverne and Shirley, with those two characters. But what was your question again?
Was it the ratings? Was it the chemistry? Did Gary say, "Oh my God, you guys are great"? How did all of a sudden you be?
You mean how did the spinoff happen?
Yeah.
Well, we went back to our little writing jobs over at Samuel Goldwyn, and about 3 weeks later, someone called, and they said. It was a friend of Penny's who was a writer for Happy Days. He said, ABC saw the Happy Days episode and they love your characters and they want to do a spinoff. Well, Penny and I had no idea what that meant. And, you know, it was like, don't call us that again until we've looked it up. And so then it just sort of snowballed from there and we found out what that was, and then the network wanted 4 episodes that they were going to buy and put on the air, and they were going to air them. And so Penny and I just naturally thought, well, they'll have 4 episodes on, and then we'll be out of here, and we'll have made our rent for the year. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly how we thought, and then the rest is just show business history.
And in those days, it was like they ordered the 4 episodes, and they were going to like put them on like on an off week of Happy Days. So whether it was a hiatus week or whatever, they go like, oh, we'll air this now, then we'll air this. So, you know, every like 4 or 5 months, they air
right.
like one episode at a time. Yeah.
Well, they aired the first one, and then the ratings went through the roof, and which also Penny and I didn't understand what ratings were at the time, but Gary Marshall, her brother, came down and said, oh my God, we overnights, yeah. 36 million people. And Penny and I, to this day, I can't fathom what 36 million. I know there's a lot of people in America, and that's how we thought of it. 36. I mean, you can't adjust that in your mind. You know, your brain can't grasp that. Anyway, so it just sort of snowballed behind us.
You know, Fred Silverman was the president of ABC at the time. So he was the brainchild. Really, he was spinning off the Bionic Woman from the 6 Million
Right.
Man.
He was. You're absolutely right about. He was like the wizard of spinoffs.
He just knew, you know, money when he saw it.
We just did a project with Fred.
Fred Silverman?
Yeah, the pilot. The company I work at is CCI, it's a post-production facility. And we just did the post-production on 2 pilots. Yeah, he came in, he was like sitting in the bay room, and you're like, oh my God, that's Fred Silverman.
Oh my gosh.
Well, you know, and one of the things about, and we've talked about this before, Cindy, Laverne and Shirley was exciting. You looked forward to it. It was like, here's Lucy, you know, when she had the curtain. Every week was a show. It was a real show. and it was the same kind of excitement that I used to get on Tuesday nights. You know, it was just something so great that expanded from Happy Days, Laverne Shirley, and onto Three's Company. That energy that we all had, basically because we didn't have smartphones and we didn't have all the technology, we just had that TV. But all that, how do you explain the excitement surrounding that?
Well, it was like the Dick Van Dyke Show, because you had marvelous writers who wanted to put on a show,
right.
Wanted to entertain people and make them laugh. It wasn't about wardrobe and hair and, you know, and fancy whatever it is about today. It was a whole other deal. It was about entertaining people and yourselves too, making yourself happy while you did it. And it was just a whole other beat. And that was it. It was a show each week. You said it, Herbie. And the same with the Dick Van Dyke Show. You look forward to seeing what these characters are up to.
And I think that, and I with the people that you're talking about, in those days, they made their shows because it was their passion. It was what they loved.
Exactly.
It was they wanted
loved
to do.
It.
They weren't they didn't care about making money. They didn't, that wasn't the motivation. It wasn't about nowadays it's all about, well, how much can I get from here? How much can I get?
Exactly.
So that I think is exactly
what you're
talking about.
Can I get on QVC with this?
Yeah.
No, and it's
it
the show's
because,
the thing.
Right.
The show's the thing. And you have marvelous writers. And they thought, like Gary would think, he'd come to Penny and myself and he'd say, what do you want to do this week? And I remember Penny saying, put us on Hooks. Mm-hmm. And so, and they'd write a show where it would end up with us on Hooks, where the bad guy puts us on Hooks. We try to get off the Hooks, because Penny said, I wonder if you could jump off a hook. So when we did that show, we had them bring, and this goes back to the old wonderful shows of your show of shows, because you wanted to make the audience like, you wanted to be ahead of them. Because when the audience is ahead, and Penny and our great audience, like you are, and I'm sure everybody on the show was, and so we were always aware of that, of the audience, because we'd always in our minds sit in the audience and watch our own, you know, what we were doing. So she wanted to actually see. So we had a mirror come in. It brought a big dance mirror in, and they put us on the Hooks, and for an hour, tried to get off of them hooks, and we couldn't get off of the hooks. We tried helping each other off of the hooks, couldn't do it, and it was funny, and we saw what was funny and what made us laugh, and we knew it would make the audience laugh, and that was kind of our litmus paper each week. What made us laugh, we felt would translate to the audience and make the audience laugh. It's the same with your cast. I mean, they were... Yeah, I mean, because you can see it. You can see the different energy. If you put the Dick Van Dyke Show, if you closed your eyes and had an audience sit and you put a show that was on today and you clicked the channel and you kept clicking through shows on today, you know, a comedy show after comedy show after comedy show, and then you clicked to the Dick Van Dyke Show, people would go, whoa! Because it's a different energy.
Yes.
And it's a friendly, fun energy.
Likeable. We talked about
yes.
that.
And it was real. And it was real.
And real. And everybody's
real.
Having
people
fun.
Like, you're like you said, you're trying to get each other off the hooks. You're like, that's real. They're like, oh, shit, I'm telling you, I gotta get this. And you're into it at the time.
And talk about the how you changed the apartment design. You talk about that in your wonderful book. How they had it more luxurious, and you thought that would be...
Right.
When
we had done the pilot, we had the sink in the living room, like the Honeymooners, you know, if anyone has ever seen the Honeymooners. And we were poor. We had to get a ride on a bakery truck to get to our date that night and off the and
the characters.
Also home. The characters. Although they did, I do call situation comedies, and this goes back to what Larry was saying about Rob Petrie being, you know, Dick Van Dyke. It's the personality plays, basically. A good situation, the personality of the actor comes through to the characters and vice versa. And the writers see it and they build toward that anyway, and then you have this marvelous little piece, hopefully. So in the beginning, we were these poor girls who were scraping to try and make the rent and pay the electric bill each month, and that was the fun of the show. And that was our audience, these blue-collar workers who lived from paycheck to paycheck, but dreamed about doing better. Dreamed about it. And so So the show is being is getting ready to start. It's our first rehearsal, and Penny and I get together, and we sneak down to the sound stage on the Paramount lot, and we want to get a look at the set. So, but we first go when there's no one there, and we open the door, we go backstage, and we look at our dressing rooms, and go, oh. And it had our names on the hall, and it wasn't a masking tape. Our real names that they had done at the shop for us. And then we had the wardrobe department and the makeup room, and we couldn't believe our good fortune, our blessing. And so we came behind and we walked up the stairs that was up to the platform where you open the door that would look like it was coming down to our basement apartment. And we threw that door open, and we looked on that set, and we were horrified because they had wall-to-wall carpeting, beautiful wallpaper, all these china little knickknacks, and gorgeous furniture, and wall hangings that were beautiful, and like furniture that we didn't have, had never seen. I'd never seen this. And we... Oh, it just let all the air out of our balloons. And so we ran, we said, this isn't wall-to-wall carpeting. So we panicked, but we pulled ourselves together and we each went home. And I went to my mother's house in the valley here in Reseda. And I got stacks of newspapers, her old movie magazines, mm-hmm. my grandmother's old doilies that had holes in them that she had crocheted, and pillows, and my old high school yearbooks, mm-hmm. and pictures of my friends, and my old junior high school car coat. Just junk. I piled the car with stuff from my room, and I went back, and she had gotten all her 45s and a hammer and nail. And she'd also brought clothes and stuff to put on the set. So we started we first took everything we could carry off the set, all the knickknacks and the wall hangings that were beautiful, and the little pieces of furniture, we hid them. We went and hid them. And then we threw all these old pillows over the couch and my grandmother's doilies and just junk everywhere. And this stack of old newspapers I have, to this day, no idea why my mother was collecting those stacks of newspapers as high. But we put it by the door, movie magazines, and she took her records, and you can see them on the set, and she hammered the 45s in on the wall. We hung them on the wall. Pictures of our friends that we had. We did the best we could. We looked at that sucker, that rug, that wall-to-wall carpeting, and thought, can't quite get that up tonight, and because just couldn't pull it because they had nailed it down. So the next morning, the you know what hit the fan, and they all came down, and we were just standing there, and we were just determined to stick to our guns, and they said, the hell happened to all the furniture and everything? What is this? What is this? And so we started making our case and say, look, these are two working girls. That's the fun of the show. If these are things, everything that was on this wall-to-wall carpeting is something they would strive for. They're striving for this in their lives. And like everybody else, wall-to-wall carpeting, beautiful furniture, matching sweater sets. Mm-hmm. If we have that to begin with, the show's gone. It's mm-hmm. over. And it took us about an hour to convince them, and finally Gary came down to the set. What's going on? and I remember the set dresser and everyone just standing, staring, and it was all men and us, me and Penny, and we just stuck to our guns and said, these are blue-collar workers. Where's the sink in our living room that we used to have? You know, that was. And so Gary said, they're right. And they readjusted everything, but they made us turn over all the tchotchkes and furniture. And they were really PO'd because of that. And the rug came up. They tacked the wallpaper down. They made it look old, you know, and worn. And they brought the carpeting up, and we have these old... Oh, and I remember Penny and I, we brought throw rugs, ugly ones, to throw on top of that carpet. So they just used those throw rugs, and they saw our point. And so that's how the wow. But oh, we almost had heart attacks when we saw that set. It was so beautiful. And they were trying, I guess, to make us happy. And the other thing we did on the show was, it was a Paramount set, lot. So they had this incredible wardrobe department, and they wanted to please us, and they wanted to make us all these beautiful costumes. And Penny and I were like totally, you know, tempted by it, but we said, no, these girls do not have this kind of stuff. And so, it just killed us. We said, we've got to, you know, give us, we can't have matching anything.
It wouldn't have been the same if they
did
that. I don't think.
But you know what? Some of my costumes had like Audrey Hepburn written in them, but they just used a skirt and it was Sabrina Fair, and then they throw an ugly top, and on me it did not look like Audrey Hepburn. Trust me. And that was, and then Penny and I, she just reminded me of this the other day. She goes, yeah, and we used to, remember Cindy, we would take all our costumes and leave them, you know, and only select from those for the whole season. Never, we repeat the costumes, in other words. We, you know, like today, there's always new, you know, they come in another outfit every time. And Penny and I just, we couldn't do it. We wanted to, but we couldn't.
Again, it was real. You made it real. Mm-hmm. That's what it was like. It's like, you just, you have to make it real. Again, you know, the audience is the audience, and they, if you don't give them something they can relate to, they just won't relate to it.
Oh, like, absolutely.
And you'd be gone. Like you said, you would have been gone.
Exactly. It wouldn't have lasted a season like that, because nobody can relate to that with these two. We couldn't. And the other thing was, Penny, and I think, I believe I said this before, when we, during rehearsals, we were so aware of our audience, and you talked about this, that's it. That's who it's for, and for ourselves. But we would always try and block things and do the physical humor and make the lines work in a way that it would make us laugh out loud during rehearsal. We'd burst out laughing because we knew, again, that would translate to the audience that would come in. Did you have a live audience?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Oh, great.
Desi Lou, three camera live.
Oh,
yeah,
that
was
us, too.
Absolutely.
We were all Desi Lou, three camera, and with the audience on the other side. So we'd always do it like a little stage play. Yeah. But if it made us laugh during rehearsal, laugh out loud. That was a test. Laugh out loud. Then we were pretty sure it would make the studio audience laugh, and then it would translate to the television audience.
Was there any conversation when you guys were writing together that one day maybe we should do a show, or wouldn't it be nice if we acted in a show together? Did you ever think that with Penny when you were before?
When we were writers before?
Yes.
Never. Nope. We were thrown into that together. We'd only met each other one time before. I write about that in the book with the... when we had double dates, she went with Rob. I don't mention any names in the book. Everybody's married to other people now. No names. I just said we double dated. And we went to see Liza Minnelli at the Coconut Grove. But opening for Liza Minnelli was Little Richard. And that's where we first met. And then we didn't see each other for a long time. I always liked her. And we were in that management company together, Gary's management company. But we just... They asked us if we would write together for this, it was Francis Ford Coppola was producing this bicentennial spoof, and it was a movie that was coming out, and it was going to come out in 1976 for the bicentennial, and it was the making of America. It was, you know, the from the Mayflower coming over on, you know, up to 1976, all done in sketches and musical numbers. And it was Harry Shearer was writing on it, Steve Martin, Martin Mull, Carl Gottlieb. But everybody was writing in teams. And so, and we were all given assignments to write. Like Penny and I had the Salem Witch Trials. Oh, did you ever get a chance to read our take on the Salem Witch Trials?
I'd love to see that.
Yeah, and anyway, so yes, we were writing at the time. We never talked about that. You know, we complain about, you know, I was getting ready to leave town because I hadn't worked really in 2 years, and then I got this little writing gig with her, but I was going to leave town to go to, where is it in Oregon?
Portland?
No,
Eugene,
not Portland. Eugene, Oregon to wait tables because I knew this little, I love this little town, and I couldn't wait tables in town because my peer group was here and I felt awkward. So I was getting ready to go to Oregon at that time, but we never talk about getting a show together. We sort of fetched a little bit about not working. Or she would say, do you remember the show That Girl?
Yeah.
Penny, she said, the last job I had when we were riding together was on That Girl. And I said, really, what part did you play? I played the girl who said, That Girl.
Let's talk a little bit about American Graffiti. And how many people over the years have always thought, and we talked about this too before, that Happy Days was kind of a spin-off from American Graffiti because Ron Howard was in Happy Days and he was also in American Graffiti, but that's just not true. Happy Days actually started out as a 15-minute pilot on Love American's Island.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
So,
And I think they didn't shelve it, but they put it on a back burner for a while. And in the meantime, American Graffiti, in the next year, American Graffiti came out and was a huge success, and because of its success, I think I got it right. I don't know, you would know, Herbie, is that right? Is that
what are you asking?
Pop history? Is that correct, that when it came out, then Paramount said, ooh, 50s, 60s, okay, and put it out?
Yeah, right, but it didn't really, it kind of all happened at the same
time.
It was very, very murky. Very, very murky. But it was a very, very different premises, really.
Oh, totally different. Oh, yeah. Except that they were placed in a time before the president was assassinated, and so it was a much happier, buoyant time in, idealistic
right.
time in
but,
history.
But you didn't get
America.
The part as surely because they saw you.
No.
That was just a nice coincidence for you.
But, and those two parts are totally different.
Right.
And you know, like I told you before, in American Graffiti, when I read it, I said, well, I don't want to play this part because she cries through the whole damn movie. I want to play the bad girl. And they said, been cast. And I said, well, what about Carol? She's 12 years old, and you're not. And I said, I could play that. I think, no, I could put braces on my teeth. And they said, no, we can't find anyone to play this part. And up till then, I had always played the lead's best friend, who always would say something like, oh, John's not going to leave you. He's going to come back. You'll see. Don't cry, Mindy. Or whatever. I was always the lead's best friend, giving her advice. And I said, I can do comedy. I want to do comedy. So, it all ran parallel, and I got my wish.
And you worked with Ron in other things as well, didn't you?
Yes, I did, in many things. In fact, when I talked to him, when I was writing the book, and I wanted to run some things past, and we had a long conversation, and he said, you know, in a way, Cindy, we were like Spencer and Hepburn, and Spencer, Tracy, and Catherine, Tracy and Hepburn, that's what he said. And I said, really? And he said, well, we played everything, because I actually, on this show, Insight, I played his mother. This is an old show, way back
Sunday
when.
Sunday mornings, ABC.
Right, and
it was a religious oriented.
And produced by a priest.
Oh.
Yes. And who always asked you for your paycheck back. He'd hand you your paycheck. He was a priest. And you, if you're a good Catholic, you give it back.
Yeah, of course.
To him. And Ron and I went in to get, oh, so Ron played in this, the premise of this episode was, I was a teenage girl who was pregnant and having a baby and having difficulty delivering the baby and questioning, am I going to give the baby up for adoption, and all these questions with a doctor on earth, while Ron, who was playing my son, about to be born, is questioning, should he be born in heaven with an angel. Mm-hmm. And so I played his mother, he played my son. Mm-hmm. And but when we went to give our checks back, pick our checks up, he said, are you going to give yours back? And I said, I don't know. He said, I'm not. I said, well, we'll just go in together. And so immediately, Ron went first. And he said, thank you, Monsignor. And put your hand on his phone. And he goes, Cindy, I want to give you this and say thank you. And I grabbed, it's just a little tug, and I said, oh, here, Father, you can have it now. But I wanted to just run out and catch Ronnie and say, how about that check is mine? How about that check is mine? But,
how old is Ron?
Ron was, when we did the Insight, I don't know, he was probably 19, 20.
Yeah. We grew up in Burbank.
Right.
We played Little League together, Ron.
Did you?
Yeah. It was like, the family, and we're right next to each other. And we shot Dick Van Dyke on the same lot as Andy Griffith.
Where was that?
It's called Renmar now. It's on Desi La Quinta. It was on Quang Willoughby. The studio on Quang Willoughby.
Oh, yeah.
We shot Dick Van Dyke, and they shot Andy Griffith just littered down a lot from us.
Wow. Willoughby, remember that? Willoughby. Yeah. 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 Twilight Zone.
Yes.
That's funny.
Talk about some of your other movies that you've done.
Just talk about them.
Meet Wally Sparks.
What are some of your favorites beyond American Graffiti?
You know, I didn't write about this little movie I did that I don't think anyone saw called Euphoria. And it was just this wonderful movie with Fred Ward and Harry Dean Stanton. And it was just terrific. And except for, Terry was my stand-in on that movie. It was a little difficult, but it was a wonderful, wonderful script, wonderful movie if you ever get a chance to see it. U-F-O-R-I-A, Euphoria. And that was one of my favorites. And The Conversation, naturally. And and I did this Roger Corman film called Gas. And that was pretty crazy. That was the first movie I ever did. And that was shot in New Mexico. And I did that with Talia Shire, who was Tally Coppola at the time. And I write about that a little bit in the book, too. But, I don't really... Yes?
How many days did they shoot that movie in?
The Roger Corman film? Oh, yeah. That's a good question. Mm-hmm. Maybe 20. Maybe like 3 weeks we shot. Oh, Bud Cort was in it also. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Bud Cort, Ben Vereen, Tally Shire, Elaine Giftos, and I can't remember who else. But it had a great cast. But Roger Corman was always great in casting people. I mean, putting things together. Yes.
Hi, Cindy.
Hi.
How was it working with Jack Lord in...
Y-5-0
and Raymond Burr in Perry Mason?
They're just like you would imagine them to be. I mean, Raymond Burr was like someone came to me and said, Mr. Burr would like to see you tomorrow morning at 7 in the judges' chambers. Because we were shooting. What the hell does that mean? And I was so enamored with Raymond Burr because as a kid, Perry Mason... And my mother and I would always try and guess who the killer was, who the real killer was. And but I loved him. He was wonderful. I mean, it was just wonderful. But when you're an actor and you work with somebody that you watched it was like surreal working with him. Jack Lord was just like that character. I mean, he was a marvelous man. And very courteous and a gentleman, a real gentleman. And I didn't have much with him because most of my scenes were with my husband. I was a teenage bride or something, and again a baby was involved. but he was a wonderful guy, Jack Lord. You could have played that baby. You could have played that baby, Larry.
You're right. You're right.
Not where you would have been. Baby,
dramatic license.
It's fine. That's right. We could have taken it.
Well, one of the things that I love about Cindy's book, and I've told you this before, is that she tells the truth of her life and her career. Certainly, there's probably going to be a sequel somewhere down the road, but she tells. She's very straight about everything, but she tells it with dignity. And there's so many books out there today, or so much bad journalism, where it's really hurtful, told in a mean-spirited way. Nobody gets along with everybody 24 hours a day. Nobody, if you're working with them or associates or people in the family. But it's the way you approach things and the way you tell a story that really shows your personhood. And you did such a wonderful job with the book. And I mean, you know, and I'm sure there were parts where you wanted to put this in that you thought to yourself, no, I better keep it up, because I've done that too with mine, so.
Well, I never was interested in writing a book that, you know, told tales or kiss and tell or threw anybody under the bus. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to write, in fact, the first title of the book was, if you can't say something nice about somebody, don't say anything at all.
There you go.
Because my mother used to always say that, just keep your mouth shut. Don't say anything unless it's something nice. And so I thought, well, that will be a pamphlet. And I tried and tried and I just wanted to do a bunch of little stories and anecdotes about my life and about what fame had afforded me, how I'd been blessed, and I had such wonderful adventures. It was like jumping down the rabbit hole to be in Hollywood at the time I was in Hollywood and enjoying that kind of blessing of success and fame. And so I wanted to share those stories because they were all fun, and I wanted to take the reader along with me. And it was very important for me to write the book, even though Dave Smitherman, my darling Dave Smitherman, who was my collaborator, I couldn't have done it without him. But he just let me go, and he would, you know, when I'd be hysterical at 4 a.m, calling him, I can't do this, he would talk me down out of the coconut tree. But, so I just wanted it to be an upbeat, happy experience, so when so you didn't feel like I need a shower after I read that story. And
you wanted people who were reading the book to be as happy as they were watching the show.
I did. I wanted the reader to have a smile on his face when he or she put the book down. But there was a time where I was reminded about certain things that people had said about me and this and that and the other and things that were out there. And someone called me up while I was writing the book, finishing the book, and they read me something. And I said, what? Right. Well, I'll just answer that. And so I did. And I put this. I did it with one sentence in the book. And I put it in there and for 8 hours. And then I wrung my hands and gnashed my teeth. And I thought, I can't do that. It makes that person look so bad. And this person... The bottom line is I love them, and I don't want that out there, and I don't care. And so I took it out, and I'm so happy that I did, because I only told the things, and I told the whole truth, but I only told the things and just left out little familial things that belonged, you know, in the laundry basket. And
you talk about your mom. Your mom was on the show,
yes.
And she was really ahead of her time. Health-wise, she used to give everybody B12 shots, right?
My mother was a fanatic about health, and little Italian woman who just, you know, cooked so great, but everything had to be healthy. And she was far ahead of her time, and she could diagnose any illness, and she had these health books. She was a total devotee to Jack LaLanne and Adele Davis, that was another one, and Dr. Bragg. And so she would always look things up in her health books and diagnose, and she'd always have the remedy. And she was so far ahead of her time. And she cured a boyfriend that I had of baldness. She grew his hair back. And it dealt with, well, you might not like this though, Larry, because it dealt with drinking yeast, eating an acidophilus and something, not olive oil. What's that horrible oil?
Castor, but
another kind of oil. But I watched my boyfriend go from a bald man to a man with all his blonde hair back again. And my mother said, keep drinking that, Harry. And he did. And to this day, when I see him, he says, look, it's Francis. So, yeah, she was great at that. She was great at it. My sister's like that, too. My sister can diagnose.
Which episode did she do?
She did a Shots Talent Show episode that Jerry Belson was in. He played his eyes. Jerry Belson played, and that was another thing. Gary would come around, what do you want to do for the talent show? And Jerry Belson, who was his writing partner for the Dick Van Dyke Show, came on and down one day, and Jerry said, Gary, I want to play my eyes. And he goes, okay. And, And so he plays his eyes. I don't know how he did it, but he plays them to the tune of something. And then, and that was the fun of that show. And there was another time where Gary, how did I get off on this? But anyway, Gary said, I found a guy today who can flip 25 quarters on his arm. He's in the talent show. He's going to be in the talent show. And he just put people in. So my mother was in this talent show and with Penny's mother. And Penny's mother had to tap because she was a dancer. And while my mother sang Pennies from Heaven. And so this is Gary Marshall again. So my mother could sing, her mother could dance. And so during rehearsals, Gary comes down and he goes, you know, Francis, he goes, props, come in here, Rennie. He said, give Francis two little baskets. So he put on my little mama, he put these two baskets and like 1,000 pennies in each basket, little basket. And so he said, Francis, when you do the song tonight, when you sing it, when the, you know, when we shoot it, just throw, when you sing Pennies from Heaven, pennies in the air. This is the genius of Gary Marshall. So my mother, during the show, and we always saved everything, the big block stuff for the show. We'd rehearse it, we'd mark it, but if it was a big physical scene, we'd just save the big stuff. So my mother sings, when it rains, it always rains. Pennies out! 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 From heaven. Out! And so all these pennies, could she really throw them up in the air and kick down on her? And so Gary said, we're going to have to fix that. And so we had to do it again. And so she threw them. And then Penny's mother was in this crazy costume. Do I have a picture of that in the book? I think I do. No, maybe I didn't. Because someone said, why didn't you have a picture of them? But she tapped to it. Anyway, it was a very sweet show. My mother was so proud of her Screen Actors Guild card and her residual to this day that are like 2 cents.
Yeah, if that. Do you get residuals?
No.
We didn't.
And you know something? Ron Howard, we were leaving, he was leaving Happy Days one day and I was leaving Laverne and Shirley. He said, Cindy, I said, well, let me ask you something. When the show is off the air and it's in reruns, do we get residuals forever? I go, well, no. We get residuals for a while, and then they keep cutting them in half, in half, in half, until there's nothing. The look of Pat, he goes, are you kidding me? You mean it runs out? I go, yeah. He goes, only I Love Lucy. Only Lucy.
Yeah, she was the only one
always
that negotiated that. And the rest of it.
No. She didn't get to Lucy.
No.
Oh, man. That was before residuals.
So she didn't get, but really?
No.
They owned the show, though.
She got, exactly. That's it. She owned it because she owned the show. Yeah. It's like Dick Van Dyke, Carl Reiner, Sheldon Leonard, and
Danny Thomas.
Danny, yeah. They got the money, but nobody else did. Right. And I remember Rosemary saying to me one day, she was like, God damn it, if I knew now what I knew then. And it, Rosemary's
and what year did that change? 78 or something?
76, 77.
I thought earlier.
I think 73, 74 maybe, something like that. Yeah.
But we did it for the love of it.
We didn't know any better.
And nowadays,
but we did.
You have to negotiate a contract so you get it in cable form. I don't even know how that works. Netflix and everything.
There's so much.
I have a question.
Yes. All right, yes!
No, I because you know I'm probably the youngest person in the room. Right now. Yes, that's at least 24. They should have their own show. But I was like, is there like any show on TV today that you feel passionate about, it, like Laverne and Shirley back in the day?
Larry, you want to feel that one?
You know, there really isn't, and I got to tell you something. I mean, there's certain dramatic shows that are really wonderful today, but in terms of comedies, when you look at it, I just don't
see... Two Broke Girls?
I just don't see anymore, and it's funny because I remember watching Laverne and Shirley. You know, I actually lost Potsy to Anson, because Jerry brought me in to do, and we went down to the two of us, and Anson, they hired Anson instead of me.
I can see you doing it.
And it was like, but again, it's like the writing, the premises, the people, they did it because it was such a passion for them, and it wasn't about trying to be funny or, you know, you and I were talking about this one time. You said, you know, now it's like, set up joke, set up joke, set up joke. And that's not what it is. That's not what we were. We were like comedy out of reality. Yeah. And I remember watching La Mercer. I love La Mercer. I love having it. I used to get there like, man, these girls work at brewery. I wish I could work at brewery. Anyway, it was. But yeah, it's really hard to say. I mean, there's. It just there's not. I mean, maybe
they don't go for characters today. There's no characters.
It's interesting.
The dialogue is interchangeable in all the shows.
That's right.
Everybody, like I said before, everybody's sarcastic. Everybody's snippy. Nobody's likable. I don't see too many likable characters.
There's supposed to be a laugh every 10 to 15 seconds now
right,
in modern comedy.
Right.
And you can't tell a story that way.
Yeah.
No.
You
guys
right.
told
That's
stories.
Yes, sir.
Along with that, do they even still film sitcoms live like they did
yes.
with all the shows back
Yeah,
back
they
still,
do.
They still
four
do
cameras.
Yeah.
They
still
do
have four cameras.
They do.
But sometimes, don't they... like shoot a scene on a Thursday and then show it to
we
the audience?
We do have pre-tapes sometimes, yes.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. But they try, I mean, the good ones try to do everything
like
in front of the audience.
Like a little play all
like
the way through.
Bill Lawrence's stuff, he'll even recreate something in front of the audience and use that laughter when they do the tape. So they'll do a post-tape if they can't do it in front of the audience
right.
for technical reasons. Yeah, so the good ones know to use the audience and cut out anything that doesn't work.
You had a question?
I was just curious, as I always have been, is there going to be a DVD box set of Laverne of all of the seasons?
I think it just came out.
The whole box set?
I think so. I don't know. They don't tell me nothing.
And they certainly don't give us anything.
No.
Anyway, I can't wait to buy it.
So you haven't done any interviews for something like The Extras?
No. You know, I'll tell you something. They did. Paramount had a 95th... anniversary, was it 95 years? Mm-hmm. No, I know they had a 75th, but 90th anniversary. And they invited all their television department and, you know, everybody, the cast from Cheers, the cast from Mork and Mindy, the cast from Happy Days, Laverne and Shirley, anyway, all their cast, Frasier, everybody. And they, of course, had all their movie stars there. And they took the big picture in front of the gates out on Melrose, and it was all exciting, you know, Annie Leibovitz. And then they had this big dinner, and then they did a big composite of all the movies, you know, beginning at the turn of the century or whatever, that Paramount had, you know, had put out. They used none of their television, not one clip from television. And they had invited everyone, and I remember Penny saying, you know, it was the television department that saved this studio, and why would they invite us all and not have the... And that's kind of how they were with Laverne and Shirley, Happy Day. The department had changed, and all the years had gone by, and they just didn't realize what they had over there. And why they didn't do it sooner, I don't know. Not with just our show, but with all the shows. They had over there Taxi, all the wonderful shows. And if you call to try and get something from them in that department, the publicity department or the ancillary right, whatever, they didn't even know the names of the shows. I mean, anyway, they've sold it all to CBS now. The CBS owns
Danny sure. Thomas said something one time, and I worked for Danny after Dick Van Dyke, when I got out of college. I worked for Danny Thomas Burke as a PA, and that's how I got back into the business. And Danny said something one time, he says, you know, people talk about features and this and that, he goes, but when history tells itself, my television shows will stand the time and remember, and that will be what holds this industry. You know, features, they're great, and you'll see them in Academy Awards, but billions of people watch TV. Only a small percentage will go see movies on that. And he was right. He was
well, and the new network, Decades, I don't know if you guys have seen it, the new Decades, it's doing exactly that. It's trying to preserve so very, you know, smartly how important classic television really has been to the development of our culture.
What is it? It's a television station?
Called Decades. Mm-hmm. There's MeTV, Antenna TV, Cozy TV, and the new one now is Decades, which is owned by CBS, so you'll probably be seeing Laverne and Shirley on Decades very soon.
Their sub-channel.
What was your favorite episode?
Oh, why?
No, to do with the stunts and all the...
To do with what?
With all the stunts and all the...
I like the hurricane show. Where we did the we that's where we go on a vacation. We can only afford a vacation to near Mexico. So we go to near Mexico, and we get this hotel room, but it's only got three walls. So in this, and they're building the wall. There's a wall that's only built in here. And they've lost our luggage, so we wear, this is my idea to wear, because Howard Hughes had, I read somewhere where he was wearing Kleenex boxes. So I said, give us Kleenex boxes as slippers, because they'd lost our luggage. So we're in Kleenex boxes and pillow slips. And this hurricane comes, and so that was a show where we just really had to market, because they brought in these wind blowers and a rain machine and all this stuff and a goat, and it all, we try to block ourselves from the wind. And anyway, it was very funny, that show, and they could only really shoot it once because they couldn't clean up the set, you know, to do it again. So that show physically, and also the physically, the Murphy bed show, where the Murphy bed tries to eat us, and because we had two guys. You were talking about a show done, you know, the other people that make the show work. There were two gaffers, and they had to. This Murphy bed, it was an electric Murphy bed, and she loses her earring on it. And it was a medallion home. And so she loses her earring on the bed. She goes, oh, and she goes to get it. And the bed goes up and then comes down. And she goes, help me. And I jump on her. And then the bed goes up again. And every time it comes down, we're in a different position. And that was so much fun to do. But there were two guys literally on these levees doing this. And we had to map that out with them like a band, you know. All right, and we couldn't talk when we did it, and we did it in one take, and at the end we go off the bed and we roll and do this carpet, this like flip, and then we look at the bed and the bed goes back down. Oh, and we did this thing. This was my favorite thing. We go toward the bed. Oh. Her earring is on the bed. This is at the beginning. And so we go over to get it, and the bed starts to go up. And so we go back, and the bed goes down. And so I remember Penny and I, when we came up with that, we thought, oh, that is so... And so we go 1, 2, and the bed would go 1, 2. And we get set back, and this is the bed would go down. So finally, that's how we got on the bed. I remember we just jumped on the bed, and then it slams into the wall. And then it comes out, and we're in these different positions, and nobody rolled off. And when we were done with that show, I turned to Penny and I said, you know, if there was an event in the Olympics, we would have medaled. So that was one of the.
Because of the era, physical comedy, you know, which you don't see a lot of anymore. Somebody asked about, you know, today with the shows, you don't see a lot, but it was the old, you know, slapstick that they encompassed.
Yeah, but
that
when they brought it back. It was even gone.
Oh no, it was. You know, like Dick was like that.
Yeah, it was.
Dick was
not
very
your
physical.
Show.
It was like, you know.
Well,
but,
we stole a lot of stuff.
You know.
Well, you said
Gary's
something interesting.
New smart guys.
You said something interesting about comedy as a. The band, you were related to music. Isn't good comedy like a good song?
It's all rhythmic.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
It's all rhythmic. And then the audience is there with you, and they're in rhythm with you. And the trick of it is to surprise the audience, mm-hmm. like a baby. You surprise them with that, and then you get the bigger laugh out of them. And that's how Penny and I had such fun trying to do that, to surprise the audience. Because the audience, and we used to always say to the writers, they're so smart. The audience is smart. You've got to write smartly for them because I remember there was there were many times where jokes would just, oh, lay there, and you just, this is horrible. Not like your show where everything was sharp, but our show, And so Penny and I remember one time I tried to make this joke work, tried everything to make this joke work, and we were about to step out on stage, and she said, do you have it? And I go, now, I think if I talk to Jesus, I think Jesus could maybe make this joke work. And we'd step out on stage and just put our heads on the chopping block, you know, each week. But that was the fun of it. That was certainly a lot of the fun of it.
I was thinking of this before you went into the physical, and you guys work so hard at the physical as well. Did you? I can't wait to read the book, by the way.
Oh, thanks.
Did you get seriously hurt in any of these stunts?
Well, the first show we did, where, because Penny and I thought in cartoon terms, because we were big Looney Tune fans, and so the first, one of the first shows, we had this fashion show, and I was supposed to be calling all, you know, and now Laverne and this beautiful, we were selling, trying to sell lingerie to our club, to our, the Debs, the, anyway, so she was supposed to come on a rope in this Tarzan teddy. And so we just marked it. We just said, okay, you'll come in on the rope, you hit the wall, you slide down the rope, and I go along with it. Well, you know, we haven't counted on gravity. And so she comes in on the rope, and I say, now Laverne, in this leopard print teddy, will show, you know, make any Tarzan, you know, look, I forget what it was. And she comes across the room and hits his wall, down on the ground. And it was like, oh my God, she can't. Why didn't you just slowly? And she goes, you know, it doesn't work. She hurt her ankle. She hurt her ankle. But we realized it didn't work like Bugs and Sylvester. So that one. And then there was this other one. Yes, it was harsh reality for us out of our cartoon minds. And so this other thing that we did was, that I wanted to do was, I was sitting on the edge of this couch in the show, Jay Leno plays her boyfriend, she wants him as a boyfriend, but he's like, wants to take her fishing and, you know, and play ball and everything, and I say, you know, that's not very ladylike, you'll never get a man that way. So I say, let me school you in this. So I won't leave her alone when they're together. And so that became like the premise for this bit. I mean, for the show, and this bit that I wanted to do is I sat on the edge, on the arm of the couch, and Jay and Penny were sitting on the couch, and they wanted to be alone. And so Jay says, so Shirley, don't you think it's time for you to leave? And I say, what? And leave you two unchaperoned? I think not. And as I say, I think not, she hits me like this, and I off the couch. Well, the way I wanted to fall was, I'm sitting like this, and I wanted to keep my legs crossed and just fall, boom, onto the floor like that. And they had written me this line where I go, after I fall and get up, I say, well, I must have dozed off. So I had the set dresser, I mean Rennie, I had the prop man pad the floor and put a, you know, put foam rubber under the a little rug here. And so when she pushed me, I did fall like that. And but I remember this thing in my back going, and then I got up and I said my line and I walked off and I got sciatica from that. But it cut it out in syndication. They cut that out and I just loved that. And the other one was when I pounced on the cookie. And I wanted to just go down. This was a show called Guinea Pigs where we need money to go to this cocktail party and it's $20 each. So we go to the boy, to Lenny and Squiggy's personal little gold mine, which is this experimental laboratory with humans. And so we turn ourselves in for 48 hours to get this $20 so we can go to this fancy cocktail party. And she doesn't sleep for 48 hours and I don't eat for 48 hours. And then we get dressed and we go. And I'm so hungry and she's so tired and they think we're women of the night. And so they have the security guard watching us. Anyway, and I can't get to the buffet table, and I'm so hungry, and this cracker falls on the floor.
It was a shrimp.
She had that in her mouth, the shrimp. And I go down to get it, and I go right onto my knees, and I eat it like, I wanted to eat it like a squirrel, you know, like a ravenous squirrel. That's the thought in my head, the picture in my head. Anyway, and that I loved also. But we had a Christian, born-again Christian censor who was on the show because it was the days where they censored shows. You know, they came down. And because of him, it made the show funnier because we couldn't do anything that was risque, nothing at all.
Very, very good point about, you know, instead of just getting a joke or getting a laugh and using a vulgar word that sounds funny, you know, you actually had to show your talent. Mm-hmm. You had to display your talent.
So did the writers. We had to invent things around it. And so...
Not take the easy way out.
No, and it was so much fun to do it that way because it was like camp. It was like church camp. And you just use these words that everybody could listen to, but they had double entendres to them. You know, there were double meanings to them. But it was so much fun because it was across the board funny. So he really kept us... You know, dotting our I's and crossing our T's and minding our P's and Q's.
Well, I don't know what to say, but I'm just a lovely evening with these two incredible talents who have meant so much to us in so many ways. And what I try to express to people who have reached millions and millions of people, you know, over the years, you have brought so much joy, you know, and don't think for a moment that you haven't made an effect, because you have, and you still will, and you forever and ever and ever, and you get to take all, I believe, you get to take all of that joy with you, but not only the joy that you have, but the joy you brought to others, you get to take it with you when you leave this world and relive it over and over. So thank you so much for being here tonight.
Answering questions. Thank you.